In the previous videos, we established the arguments for the two major proposals regarding the date of the Exodus. The late date proposal, which places the Exodus in ancient Egypt's 19th dynasty, and the early date proposal, which places it approximately 200 years earlier during the 18th dynasty. We've also finished examining some very interesting circumstantial evidence relative to the Exodus narrative in ancient Egyptian history, such as the frequency of the name Moses during the New Kingdom, the presence of Egyptian cognate words in Exodus, the rise of Akhenaten's pagan monotheism, and the mention of the Habiru in the Amarna letters. As mentioned previously, one of the biggest issues scholars face in placing the Exodus in history is a lack of Egyptian records of the events recorded in the biblical narrative. This lack of any Egyptian documentation has only furthered the debate over the date of the Exodus. In light of this, we concluded by asking if there is anything we can look for in Egypt that would give credibility to the Exodus account. The answer is yes. Perhaps the two things that the Exodus is most famous for are the 10 plagues God brought on Egypt for refusing to let the Israelites go, and the miraculous crossing of the Israelites through the Yam Suf, the Red Sea, which resulted in the drowning of Pharaoh's army. If we are going to regard the Exodus narrative seriously, then there are two major consequences that we can look for in the historical record. Number one, the economic collapse of the Egyptian state, and number two, a period of Egyptian military weakness. The economic collapse of Egypt would be the result of both having lost a substantial labor force in Hebrew slavery and the destruction of people and property by the plagues. The military weakness would be the result of the entire royal army having been drowned, or at least a major portion of it. These two phenomena present an opportunity for us to establish a synchronism. A synchronism is something that is attested among multiple sources. In the second video of this series, I gave an overview of ancient Egyptian chronology. Recall that ancient Egyptian chronology is, for the most part, a relative chronology. That is, it is organized in relation to events specific to Egypt, usually the reigns of individual pharaohs. The challenge for scholars is to fix this relative chronology to an absolute dating scheme. The foundation for doing this is to look for synchronisms in the historical and archaeological records. With regards to the Bible, one of the most accepted synchronisms is the campaign of Pharaoh Shoshank, presumably recorded in the Bible as Shishak in 1 Kings chapter 14 and 2 Chronicles chapter 12. The Bible describes Shishak as attacking Jerusalem in the fifth year of Rehoboam, Solomon's son. Rehoboam is thought to have come to power around 930 BC. The fifth year of his reign would therefore be 925 BC. Egyptian records of Shoshank document this pharaoh's campaigns in Canaan. The similarities between the names of Shishak and Shoshank, as well as the documentation of both kings' military activities in and around Canaan, Israel, and Judah, has been satisfactory for most scholars to consider this a synchronism. As a result, when scholars build out the surrounding Egyptian and biblical chronology, they can reference this fixed point. Returning to the Exodus specifically, the lack of Egyptian documentation does not allow for us to establish a synchronism with the Bible on textual grounds. However, recognizing the inevitable consequences of the Exodus, if the Bible's testimony is to be taken seriously, we could establish a synchronism and, by extension, a fixed date, if we can identify an economic and military collapse of Egypt during the time frame suggested by the scriptures. Thus, a rather simple solution presents itself to the question of the date of the Exodus. Take the earliest possible date and the latest possible date and look for a time when Egypt experienced both economic and military collapse. At this point, though, we run into a bit of a hurdle. The New Kingdom is widely considered to be the most powerful and affluent time in pharaonic Egypt. The 18th dynasty pharaohs Thutmose I, Thutmose II, Hatshepsut, Thutmose III, Amenhotep II, and Thutmose IV were able to expand Egyptian hegemony up through Canaan and Syria, even so far as the Euphrates River in Mesopotamia. These territorial gains were fixed with a treaty between Thutmose IV and Artatama I, the king of Egypt's rival state at this time, the Kingdom of the Mitanni. This territorial expansion was unprecedented and was only possible due to the strength and wealth of Egypt during the 18th dynasty. Egyptian influence in the Levant would largely be reestablished during the reigns of the early 19th dynasty pharaohs, Ramses I, Seti I, and Ramses II, culminating in another Egyptian peace treaty, this time with their new rival, the Hittites, following the Battle of Kadesh during the reign of Ramses II. Again, these territories could not have been subdued had it not been for a thriving Egyptian state. However, if we plot these two periods of conquest on our timeline, we observe that there are around 100 years in between these two periods of expansion. What happened during this time that resulted in the Egyptians having to reacquire their territories in the Levant? The pharaohs who ruled during this roughly 100-year period are as follows: Amenhotep III, Akhenaten, whom we have previously met, perhaps the most famous pharaoh of all, Tutankhamun, I, and Horemheb. With consideration specifically to Akhenaten, we see that the testimony of the Amarna letters during his reign documents the presence of a group known as the Habiru, attacking Egyptian vassal states in Canaan. With respect to these documents, they also indirectly testify to one of two phenomena during the reign of Akhenaten. Number one, that Akhenaten's foreign policy was so apathetic that he did not care to address the concerns of his allies. Or, number two, the strength of Egypt's military during Akhenaten's reign was too weak for him to support his allies. Like his religious upheaval, the reasons for Akhenaten's disregard for Egyptian allies in the Levant have been and continue to be shrouded in ambiguity. Many scholars, for lack of any other explanation, favor the former idea, citing Akhenaten's religious zeal as a source of tunnel vision that blinded him to the needs outside of his court. However, this rationale is highly speculative. Because of this, I believe it is at least reasonable, if not flat-out warranted, that scholars should consider the possibility that Egypt's military was too weak to render a defense of their Canaanite vassals at this time. Indeed, during Akhenaten's reign, Egypt's new ally, the Kingdom of Mitanni, began to be devastated by their common enemy, the Kingdom of Hatti, known to the authors of the Bible as the Hittites. Egypt and Mitanni were the two superpowers of the ancient Near East. The allegiance of these two kingdoms represented a near monopoly of this region, as any form of outside competition toward one would have invoked the full military aid of the other. This understanding is revealed in other documents of the Amarna letters, sent from the Mitanni king Tushratta to Akhenaten. However, the testimony of these letters is that help from Egypt never came. In fact, the Hittite king Supaluliuma sacked the Mitanni capital of Washukani and annexed former Egypto-Mitanni territory in the Levant. This campaign effectively ended the Mitanni hegemony in the ancient Near East, and would be the genesis of their final collapse in the near future. Through all of this, Egypt did nothing to respond to their Mitanni allies, or to even preserve their own territorial holdings from incursions by the Hittites. Why? Though this series of events is outside of the periphery of the Bible, it is important to consider due to its evidence of Egypt's state of affairs. I believe it is absurd to cite complacency or blind apathy on the part of the Egyptian royal court as the reason for this lack of action. For around 150 years prior, it was considered almost obligatory by the 18th dynasty pharaohs to maintain a northern border at the Euphrates River, and to flex their imperial might against any and all types of competition and dissension in the Levant. Through the reign of Thutmose IV, Egypt was the most powerful, most wealthy nation in this part of the world. They had more gold than they knew what to do with, and they had an army that refused to come in second place. Yet, In the space of merely two pharaonic reigns, Egypt has become a weak, apathetic state, unwilling or unable to even defend its own territories, much less uphold those of its allies. Moreover, Egypt's public perception at this time is such that a hostile king feels free to launch multiple attacks against Egypt's ally and vassals without fear of reprisals. For all of this, the Egyptian testimony is near silent. What happened to Egypt between the reign of Thutmose IV and Akhenaten that would result in this incredible power shift? The death of Thutmose IV was apparently premature. Examination of his mummy has led scholars to assume a time of death between 25 and 28 years of age, free from indications of disease or trauma. The result is that his successor, Amenhotep III, likely came to power as a child, evidenced by his long reign of 38 years. If this is the case, then the early years of his reign would most probably have been overseen by other high court officials, perhaps his mother and/or one of the viziers of his father, Thutmose IV. It's during this time that the power shift begins to take place. As rebellions typical of the Levant begin to spring up, Amenhotep III does nothing to suppress them, effectively withdrawing Egyptian hegemony in the region. This policy would persist and degrade to its fullest expression in the subsequent reign of his son, Akhenaten. To be fair, Amenhotep III's reign was remembered domestically as one of peace and prosperity. However, the lack of activity in the Levant has brought some Egyptologists to regard this peace and prosperity as less than the ancient Egyptians have cracked it up to be. Although Amenhotep III inherits the greatest world power of his day, he does little to preserve it. Indeed, as R. Givian recognizes, his rule heralds a weakening of Egypt's position in the world. Further, A. Gardner reminds us that it is wrong to regard Akhenaten as the sole pharaoh responsible for the loss of Egyptian prestige, for Amenhotep III was at least equally to blame. Unlike his imperial forebears, Amenhotep's colonial government is lax in the extreme. From this point on, Amenhotep lapses into the lethargic and voluptuous existence of an Oriental despot, degenerating into a senile voluptuary, who, for some unknown reason, is unwilling or unable to address the deteriorating situation in Egypt's Asiatic territories. Given the highly propagandistic tendencies of the pharaonic courts, it is plausible that much of what was communicated about Amenhotep III or remembered of him by future Egyptians was not an accurate picture of Egyptian stability. Living off of the spoils and influence of his predecessors, the once mighty 18th dynasty of Egypt begins a rapid decline over the course of his reign. A curiosity that shows up during Amenhotep's reign is the increased deference to the Aten, the deity that would later be given exaltation as the one true god of Egypt during the reign of Akhenaten. In the previous video, I put forth the possibility that Akhenaten's religious activity may have been a reaction to the destruction and humiliation brought on Egypt in the Exodus, if the early date of the Exodus is to be favored. If this understanding is correct, then we must extrapolate that reasoning back into Amenhotep's reign. Though he did not go so far as his son would, perhaps Amenhotep's increasing deference to the Aten was a similar result of an event or sequence of events that demonstrated the impotence of Egypt's more traditional gods. So what do we have at this point? By the end of the reign of Thutmose IV, Egypt is the power in the ancient Near East, rivaled only by the kingdom of Mitanni, who is now Egypt's number one ally. By the reign of Akhenaten, Egypt is an apathetic, impotent, also-ran on the world stage, with their number one ally on the edge of total destruction, most of this degradation having taken place during the reign of Amenhotep III between them. With consideration to this pool of data, it is more than reasonable to say that something devastating happened to Egypt either at the end of the reign of Thutmose IV or at the very beginning of the reign of Amenhotep III. By most chronologies, this time is awfully close to the time frame established for the early date of the Exodus by the variant readings of 1 Kings 6:1. Given the flexibility present in the reconstructions of Egyptian chronology, we must consider that this event or sequence of events, whatever it was, actually did occur in the time frame of the early date proposals. Thus, the obvious question is, was the Exodus the event that resulted in the collapse of ancient Egypt's 18th dynasty? But before we consider that, we also need to see if there is a breakdown of Egyptian power and influence around the late date proposal, specifically in the beginning of the 19th dynasty, prior to the reign of Merimtah. The 19th dynasty began with the reign of Ramses I. By this time, Egypt was trending upwards from the low point of the end of the 18th dynasty. Ramses I only reigned for a few years before he was succeeded by his son, Seti I. Seti reigned for around 10 years, but during his time, Egypt began to reestablish its holdings in the Levant. Seti was then succeeded by his son, Ramses II, the proposed pharaoh for the late date of the Exodus. As mentioned previously, Ramses II's reign lasted approximately 65 years. His reign saw more expansion, wealth, and influence than any since the beginning of the reign of Amenhotep III. It was during Ramses II's reign that Egypt would garner enough military power to put a stop to the expansion of the now imperial Hittites, the same Hittites who destroyed Mitanni during the reign of Akhenaten. This results in another major alliance following the Battle of Kadesh. By the time Merimtah comes to power, Egypt enjoys renewed prominence with the Kingdom of Hatti over the ancient Near East. When we consider the inevitable consequences of the Exodus, there is simply no evidence for any economic or military weakness during or in the wake of Ramses II's reign. I believe this is the nail in the coffin for the late-date proposal. To propose the Exodus during the reign of Ramses II inevitably results in the compromise of the Bible's testimony to accord it with the historical record. This is the reason why so many scholars today downplay the Exodus narrative. Egypt was simply too powerful and too wealthy during the reign of Ramses II. For the biblical account to accord with this time period. Rather than reconsidering their dating of the Exodus, scholars instead question the veracity of the Bible, interpreting the text in such a way as to make the account fit with their assumptions. I sincerely believe that if we are going to take the Bible seriously, an early date proposal in or around 1450 to 1400 BC is the only reasonable option. It just so happens that when we do this, the inevitable consequences of the Exodus lead to a time in Egypt that is remembered as weak, apathetic, and embarrassing by future Egyptians. What are the odds that these events are not synonymous? This is the theory put forth by Stephen Collins in his book, Let My People Go. In the last few years, however, there has been a popular documentary released called Patterns of Evidence, which proposes another theory that we have yet to explore, that the early date of the Exodus of around 1450 to 1400 BC coincides not with ancient Egypt's 18th dynasty, but rather with the Middle Kingdom. What are the strengths and weaknesses of assigning a Middle Kingdom date for the Exodus rather than an 18th dynasty date? We will examine some of these in the next video. Please subscribe and click the notification bell so that you will be notified when I release the upcoming videos in this series. For further reading on this subject, I recommend Let My People Go by Stephen Collins. You will find a link to this book in the description.